Good morning. My name is Alan Yang from ECS department. And myself and also our faculty member, we are also running a new center, core Center for Augmented Cognition. Today, I would like to share with you some of the very exciting activities in research and education in our College of Engineering. So one of the hot area actually in the Silicon Valley and also around the world is in augmented reality and virtual reality. Just this year in 2016, we have seen at least four very exciting products actually getting into the hands of the consumers. For example, from Facebook, we have Oculus, and from Microsoft, we have HoloLens. And this month, and Sony is going to announce their own VR product. And I think many people actually know Pokemon Go. And I want to see a show of hands again. How many of you actually have tried the Facebook Oculus? Okay, just a few of you. How many of you have tried Microsoft HoloLens? I think a little bit less. And how many of you have tried the Pokemon Go on your phone? Okay, now we have more. So just a shout out here. Actually, the founder of Pokemon Go, if you don't know, John Hank, he actually is also a Berkeley Haas alum. For that particular reason, and the company, for that particular reason, the company has placed strategically some unique monsters around our campus. So take the advantage today to actually catch those monsters just to be safe, you know, just make sure that you are safe. Now, and I have all seen that some of you may not actually have ever experienced the AR and VR experience before, but no worries, actually, you can actually, you know, recall some of the glimpse of the technologies if we walk down the memory lane. You know, I know that some of you may be fans of Star Trek, right? Now, you know that there is a device in Star Trek called the Holodeck, and it is actually conceived based on virtual reality.
I have something in Saturn.
Begin chapter 30.
And then the whole empty room turned into a virtual reality.
Try looks like you're having a good time.
You know, other than these two characters, all the sound, music, and then the dancers, you know, and they are all virtual. And then you can be immersed in this environment, and then you can just have a good time. Or you're just trying to escape the board, right?
No, look at me. Try to act naturally.
All right. In Star Wars, and then you know that what that motivates Luke Skywalker to, you know, venture out and in the galaxy far, far away actually was a fragment of Princess Leia's hologram, which is another name for augmented reality.
Now let's see if we can't figure out what you are, my little friend, and where you come from.
I saw part of the message.
I seem to have found it.
General Kenobi, years ago you served my father in the Clone Wars. Now he begs you to help him in his struggle against the Empire. I regret that I am unable to present my father's request to you in person, but my ship has fallen under attack, and I'm afraid my mission to bring you to Alderaan has failed. I have placed information vital to the survival of the Rebellion into the memory systems of this R2 unit. My father will know how to retrieve it. You must see this droid safely delivered to him on Alderaan. This is our most desperate hour. Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope.
I think it's safe to say that it's these wonderful visions that actually drove not only the moviegoers, but also researchers, you know, like us, to actually continue to innovate and study how actually we can actually develop new concepts in AR and VR in this space. So these are the concept actually has been, you know, in academia, people have been working on in the past 50 years. But since 2012, something magical has happened. Then these abstraction and concepts that people thought that only exist in movies suddenly become household names and even commercial product we can, you know, put our hands on. For example, in 2012, Google announced the Glass product, which revolutionized how the head-up display, you know, was designed. You know, in the past, you have to spend tens of thousands, but in here on the Google Glass, it's basically a piece of head-up display that costs about, you know, a few hundred dollars. In 2012 and also in 2004, you know, we have Oculus Rift and HTC Vive basically also put the concept of Holodeck in reality. And we just, you know, have some fun about the Pokemon Go, but in 2006. But if you dig into the technology archives, in 2012, Qualcomm, in partnership with Disney, actually has put out a demo that actually let you play it with the Sesame Street characters, you know, on a piece of tablet. Okay. And in 2012, myself personally actually joined a startup team called Athir, which is a company in Mountain View. And then we designed one of the first 3D gesture interface that in real time can allow you to use native hands to manipulate 3D virtual content in space. So much similar to what Tom Cruise can do, was able to do in the movie Minority Report. Now, if you're interested in all these kinds of visions, you may actually ask that, if you're ready today to declare that augmented reality or virtual reality is your dream career, what kind of resources you can get at Berkeley? Well, first one I want to let you know is that in 2015, myself and helped a group of very highly motivated undergrad students to start a VR club, Berkeley VR Club, who is going to do a demo today for all of you guys in the Jacobs Institute. At the beginning, we only had about 5 people, and in the past 12 months, we have seen tremendous interest and growth about our membership. Basically, most of our students in the Cal Day, when they've gone onto the AR and VR headset, they just couldn't put it down. They just couldn't put it down. And then in this semester, our enrollment period, we received more than 200 applications. More than 40 times growth. And I will encourage you to go to our website, vr.berkeley.edu, and then you can check out more than 10 independent student projects on the website. In 2016, we also started a new center with the goal to mainly support the faculty and graduate students doing research. And one of the unique, I think, character of this center is that not only we have professors in EECS, mechanical engineering, we also have a big umbrella, a big tent from other part of the campus. For example, we have professors from Haas Business School, Lee Fleming, and we also have serial entrepreneurs such as Jack McCauley. He is the co-founder of Oculus, and we also have Ren Ning, so he is the founder of Lytro Camera. And we are also currently developing new programs for master students, for students who actually don't need to take a 5-year PhD degree. And we're actually working at the Fung Institute for Engineering Leadership, and then we are planning in next year to launch a Master of Engineering program for AR and VR. For AR VR space. If you're interested in this area, to take a master program, definitely actually keep that in mind. So to finally, I want to show you 2 videos from our student, and I think that you will enjoy it. The first one actually is called Open ARK. Many of you know actually one of the tradition of Berkeley, the hallmark tradition of Berkeley, is open source research. So last year, our students actually take some of the off-the-shelf components and design a open source AR glasses. So you don't have to wait for Microsoft HoloLens and so on and so forth. Now, with this type of devices, remember it's open source, it's off the shelf, it's not too pretty. And what can you do with it? Well, if you load our software on the device, you can do this. I call this the Pokemon Go of the future with interactive gesture control. Wouldn't it be nice? Finally, let me show you one last video, and this is called VR Campanile, and this is entirely designed and coded by our undergrad students.
The Campanile is the most iconic symbol of UC Berkeley, and at its peak sits the carillon, a massive instrument consisting of 61 bells. All around Berkeley, you can hear it ringing the hour and broadcast music, but few people ever get the chance to go near it, let alone play it. Through virtual reality, however, this can be achieved pretty easily. The intention of the virtual Campanile is to give people a chance to experience playing the instrument for themselves. The HTC Vive was the perfect platform for this project. The 360-degree room-scale motion tracking allows you to move around freely and hit the keyboard precisely. Now I'll let my team talk about how we put this together.
Using recorded sound samples provided to us by the Berkeley Carillon Guild, we were able to recreate the full set of bells of the Sather Tower Carillon. We imported the audio samples into the digital audio workstation, Ableton Live. Then, we cleaned the samples using equalization to remove excess noise and create a clearer overall sound.
We focused on the Carillon room and the keyboard. We began in Maya by designing a single key and pedal, then duplicated them to create the instrument, modeled after real Carillon blueprints. Finally, we stitched these designs together with clouds, models of buildings around the Campanile, and the tower itself.
With the sounds recorded and models built, it was time to put everything together into Unity. We attached a spring to each key to make it move realistically, then used a physics framework called Newton VR to support controller interactions. Finally, we made it so that the corresponding sound would play whenever a key was pressed.
The virtual Campanile was very well received on Cal Day 2016. People would wait in line for 30 minutes to try our demo. And I remember that almost everyone, especially kids, would end their demo with a glissando, which is sliding across all the keys. While anyone can have fun playing the virtual Campanile, dedicated Carillon players can also use our platform to practice at their convenience. However, it still has room for improvement and creativity. For example, we're adding a Guitar Hero mode for people without previous training. Overall, we're just excited that we can bring this unique Berkeley treasure to the general public.
All right. Make sure that I run all the credits. So finally, I will just say that, you know, thank you again for coming back to Berkeley. And the faculty and students at Berkeley, we are continuing innovating at the frontier of science and technology. And I just want to thank you for your support, you know, as alums, parents, and students. Thank you very much.